The best choice here is E, callosal agenesis, or the most severe form of callosal malformation, callosal dysgenesis, with complete absence of the corpus callosum. So agenesis of the corpus callosum. One of the features that's quite classic for agenesis of corpus callosum is on axial view, you see this parallel appearance of the lateral ventricle. For normal case, the lateral ventricle is this crescentic shape, and typically the body come closer toward the midline. And in the setting of agenesis or severe dysgenesis of corpus callosum, you will see this parallel appearance of the lateral ventricle or the body or lateral ventricle, and they are typically much more whitened compared to the normal subject. Another classic feature you can see on the coronal view is this so-called Texas Longhorn sign. For a normal subject, you have a corpus callosum, so that's sort of preventing or pushing down the lateral ventricle. In the case of the absence of the corpus callosum, you have this abnormal upturn of the lateral ventricle. That gives the appearance of a Texas Longhorn. Some people think it looked like a Viking helmet, so it's also referred to as Viking helmet sign or the moose head sign. I don't know, use your imagination, you know, go smoke something and come up with something more creative. So Texas Longhorn sign. On the sagittal view, you have this radial appearance of the gyrus due to absence of the corpus callosum as well as absence of the singular gyrus. This is another example of a classic picture of agenesis of the corpus callosum. You can see on the sagittal view, there's complete absence of the corpus callosum, so agenesis of corpus callosum, as well as the absence of the singular gyrus, making this spoke-like radial appearance gyri. On the coronal view, again, the Texas Longhorn sign, the upturn of the frontal horn of the lateral ventricle with absence of the corpus callosum, parallel appearance and whitening of the body of the lateral ventricle, and the classic dilatation of the atrium and the occipital horn of the lateral ventricle, referred to as cobocephaly. As far as association with corpus callosum dysgenesis, there are probably too many disease entity or the malformation to list. So on board exam, if they show you a complex brain malformation, one of the safer answer, perhaps if you don't know the correct answer, and they ask you the association with other brain anomaly, maybe you can guess corpus callosum dysgenesis just because it's associated with so many different malformation. Not uncommonly though, with callosal dysgenesis or especially with agenesis, you will see association with other findings such as interhemisphere cysts or sometimes with lipoma. As in this case, you have a large pericallosal lipoma. That may be something that kind of throw you off a little bit when you first look at this case. And with pericallosal lipoma, the location pericallosal is the most common location for intracranial lipoma. There are two types, one's tubular nodular type, like in this case. Usually they are much thickened, about greater than 2 centimeters in thickness, typically involving the anterior aspect of the corpus callosum, sometimes associated with other frontal facial anomalies. So this is a more severe form compared to curvilinear, typically involving the more posterior aspect of the corpus callosum and a lot thinner, less than 1 centimeter thick. So for interhemisphere cysts, and these are two examples of such, both of them, as you can see, has a parallel appearance of the lateral ventricle, as well as dilatation of the atrium and the occipital horn, so cobocephaly. There are two types of interhemisphere cysts, type 1 and type 2. Type 1 simply refers to if the cyst is communicating with the third ventricle. So essentially a diverticulum of the third ventricle, that's type 1. Type 2, you do not see the communication between the cyst and the ventricular system. So that's the correct answer for this case. Let's examine other choices that do not work as well. So if you see there's presence of fat, and you can pretty much eliminate choice B as well as choice C, so neither one of the lesions should contain fat. As you can see, there's a complete fat signal drop after a fat saturation sequence on T2 as well as post-contrast T1. So two of the choices, choice A and choice D, do contain some fat element, sometimes quite a bit. for intracranial dermoid, this is a nice example of intracranial dermoid, you can see that there is a fatty lesion with a lot of T1 shorting or bright T1 signal with subsequent signal drop after fat saturation. Compared to a relatively homogeneous signal of a lipoma, the dermoid tend to be a lot more heterogeneous in signal intensity. Interestingly, in this case, you can also see there's a non-dependent layer of the fat element, so fat flows to the top. So this is a ruptured dermoid. Again, the dermoid tend to be a lot more heterogeneous compared to lipoma, and typically they do not contain as much fat tissue as, of course, lipoma does. For teratoma, also, you can see in this example, neonate, the teratoma tend to be a lot more heterogeneous as well. So in this mature teratoma, you can see quite a bit of fat element with T1 shortening. And on the post-contrast, a lot of tissue that's not fat shows avid enhancement. So with this degree of enhancement, obviously lipoma should not enhance. So you should not confuse this entity with lipoma. And here you can see that there is fat saturation or the signal drop after fat saturation. Very heterogeneous, contain fat, contain tissue, contain cystic component, and often contain some element of calcification as well. So that's mature teratoma. So this is an example of callosal agenesis plus pericallosal lipoma. That's all for this pediatric neuro case number 7. Thank you for your attention and good luck on your board exam.